W.F. House presents an unabridged recording of The Distant Dead by Lesley Thomson, narrated by Richard Attlee.
Part 1. Prologue. Thursday, the 12th of December, 1940. It used to be that a clear night with stars and a full moon spelled romance and love. Now, with the end of the longest period of all clear since intensified raids began, the cloudless sky spelled death. In the small hours, the sky billowed with smoke from fires caused by incendiaries that pulverized pavements, destroyed homes, eviscerated lives. Etched against the smog in a street near the River Thames, blacked-out windows offered blank countenances. Their occupants crouched in shelters, cellars, and under kitchen tables. The tide had turned, and the river welled over the camber near the eyot. In the moonlight, the flotsam of bottles and lengths of scorched timber resembled severed limbs. A man and a woman, clinging close, wove along eyot gardens. The woman flinched at a crash which sounded nearby, but was miles to the east. In Trilby and Mac, the man was her hero as he hustled her into a house on the corner by the Thames. Inside, he kicked shut the front door, and when he flicked an electric light switch, a glass chandelier at variance with a suburban villa flooded the herringbone-tiled hall in remorseless light. Clasping his lover's chin with an elegant hand, his whisper might have been, "I love you," or it might not. Hours passed. Fog rolled in, slick and poisonous, shrouding the river. Yet, obscuring London from the Luftwaffe, it was the city's friend. The roar of engines and the thunder of explosions ceased as planes returned to Germany. Destruction done, they dropped the last of their payload over Sussex before they crossed the English Channel. A scream. Elemental. Animalistic. Silence. No doors were opened, no sashes were flung up. If walls had ears, they did not hear. Chapter 1. December 2019. Jackie.
Clean slate for a fresh start. Beverly speaking. How may I help you?
Beverly Jameson, blonde hair streaked with silver and a diamante beaded scrunchie snatching it high up in a palm tree effect, a short skirt over leggings and cherry blossom Dr. Martens, rocked back in her chair, pen aloft. Jackie felt satisfaction at Bev's opener. It was a good while, 8 years, since she'd weaned Bev off her dreadful sing-song rap to answer in lovely, warm tones. Not that it was genuine. With Stella no longer there, neither of them felt as cheerful as Bev was sounding. In the mornings, it was all Jackie could do to get out of bed.
Hello? Clean slate? Bev here? Hello? Look, is someone there?
The tone was cooling.
Please speak?
Bev put down the receiver.
Oh, that's got to be the sixth time this week. I should have kept a record. Thursday morning, 9:10. Right.
She flung down her pens and addressed the phone.
Whoever you are, bring it on. Well, could be a wrong number, Jackie said. I swear someone's there. He listens and doesn't speak. Well, you think it's a man?
Jackie was completing a contract on a bi-weekly clean of a church hall. Usually, by the start of December, her in-tray was groaning with new business, people wanting super-clean homes for Christmas. But at this rate, they'd be letting go of those cleaners who hadn't already migrated to a more successful company. Jackie dreaded the possibility she might have to give the loyal old-timers, Wendy and Danette, who'd been at school with Stella, their cards. Once, good operatives were hen's teeth. Now, clean slate had teams to spare, but no work for them.
He has to be a man. I mean, what woman would do...
Beverly jerked her shoulders in an exaggerated shudder.
Creeps me out. Could be a mystery shopper.
Jackie couldn't bear this idea. The vultures were circling. It was, however, a distraction from her constant fretting about Stella. If Clean Slate didn't need cleaners, they wouldn't need office staff. Susie, Stella's mum, was in Sydney visiting her son, but she could update the customer database from there, and anyway, she'd stopped drawing a salary. Of all of them, Susie was the least worried. Just like her father leaving the baby for others to hold, Stella will sort herself out and be back. Jackie could manage. She and Graham had savings and were mortgage-free. Bev and her wife had just bought a flat in Richmond, so if Jackie had to let her go...
If it was mystery shopping, he'd probe us about our services and waste time so we couldn't bring in real new business.
Bev was grim-faced.
I've got a nasty feeling it's some weirdo after Stella. But why now? She hasn't done any interviews. Oh, I'm sure it's not.
Jackie felt queasy. More than once she'd encouraged Stella to do an interview with reporter Lucy May for the local paper. The detective's daughter, who cleaned for a living, had, after her father's death, solved several murders. In the past, publicity had drummed up new customers for Clean Slate. But a recent article had also drummed up admirers who, seeing Stella's photograph in the paper, wanted her to do more for them than clean. Jackie sought to reassure Bev and herself about the anonymous caller.
Well, at least he won't find Stella in Tewkesbury.
Chapter 2, December 2019. Stella. Stella Darnell loved cleaning, to make surfaces shine and restore order from chaos. Deep cleaning was her passion, but it wasn't allowed in the Abbey. The handout from the church's conservation trust said to ignore your usual standards. A church will never be free of dust or cobwebs. No aggressive cleaning products like furniture cream or silicone polish, the favoured weapons in Stella's usual armoury. The handout said to clean gently and sympathetically. After several shifts in Tewkesbury Abbey, Stella found this worked for her too. She loved her mornings being sympathetic with the tombs.
Well, that's a warning to the living.
A man was leaning against the portico to the south ambulatory.
To remember the grisly, gruesome aspect of death. It's not all angels and lambs.
Taken by surprise, Stella dropped the dusting brush.
What is?
She scrabbled for the brush on the stone floor of the side chapel.
What you're cleaning? It's a cadaver tomb.
Arms folded, the man smiled.
Christ, you got to clean the whole abbey with a small brush.
Only the carvings, otherwise I've got a larger one. Stella flicked the sable into the crevice between the upturned feet of the figure lying on the tomb.
They were a macabre thing in medieval times. You're cleaning vermin which feasts on the rotting corpse. See, there's a mouse. That's a toad.
He took a step closer.
Yeah, fascinating. Those indentations were scored by early visitors to the abbey leaving their mark. These days they have historic value.
He was too close. Security patrolled regularly. 10 minutes earlier, one had pointed out Stanley lifting his leg against a pillar by the nave. Stella had mopped it up.
There are about 50 cadaver tombs in churches in Britain. I mean, they had a right to be obsessed with death. There were many visitations of pestilence in the last part of the 14th century.
He came over and rested his arms on the recumbent figure.
This one is the starved monk, a.k.a. the Wakeman Cenotaph, and not that Wakeman himself is interred here.
Stella shot a glance at Stanley. Dogs were for protection, but her miscreant poodle had twisted round and was preening his tail.
Seriously, though, you do this every morning?
The man was grinning.
One hell of a gig!
No, this week I'm cleaning here, in the Wakeman Cenotaph at the end of the North Ambulatory. We have a rota... Stella stopped. There had been several recent muggings. A handbag snatched in the presbytery, a verger attacked by a gang in balaclavas, his arm broken and his watch stolen. If this man was checking out Tewkesbury Abbey, he'd start by buttering up one of the cleaners.
The Abbey is closed. How come you're here?
Well, in my job, it's my business to flout rules. That's how you learn stuff.
He moved towards Stanley, presumably thinking fussing her dog was the way in. Stanley whipped around, panting from his preening, and bared his teeth.
That's a warning to the living, Stella said.
The Ralph Lauren combat jacket, hair escaping from under a black beanie, and glasses stamped with Armani didn't fit a mugger, unless he was wearing what he'd nicked. He was late 40s, surely too old for mugging. Except Stella's inner policeman's daughter voice proclaimed that rubbish. Anyone could mug anyone.
Never approach a dog unawares.
The man was holding out a hand for her to shake.
Roddy Much, of course.
Of course? Stella laid her brush on the ribcage of the starved monk and made a quick decision. I'm Beverly.
Beverly? I thought...
March appeared wrong-footed. I have to get on. Stella withdrew her hand and swished the brush over the monk's protruding bones. March was likely a harmless geek who toured churches collecting weird facts, but her 3 mornings cleaning the abbey had become precious and Stella wanted to clean alone.
I'm a podcaster, March said.
Oh, right.
Stella felt that in this conversation, which she didn't want, she had nothing to say. She never listened to podcasts, and what she knew about history could be cobbled into a handout.
Deep reporting is the way forward.
On cadaver tombs? Deep cleaning certainly was. Stella gave the monk a final brush.
You could say that, he laughed. Hey, I'm building tons of followers. You should join the conversation.
He was rummaging in one of the pockets of his jacket.
I have to work.
An inane response, but Stella had no inclination to join in a conversation now or any time. She'd come to Tewkesbury, she had told Jack, because she needed space. So far, she had found it, but not this morning.
Here, you need my card. Check out my podcast. Radio Public's a cool platform, but I'm everywhere. I've potted out one ep, so you don't have to play catch-up.
March tossed his fringe. Actually, if you fancy it, we could... Stella was reprieved by March's phone. The ringtone, a haunting electronic tune which he allowed to play out as, spinning on his heel, he answered the call out in the ambulatory.
Whatcha?
Stella stuffed the card in her fleece pocket. She was interested in the concept of a cadaver tomb. She looked closely at the starved monk. She no longer saw a collection of surfaces with crevices into which she must flick her brush. The emaciated body lying on the plinth was indeed teeming with creatures, lizards, snails, the mouse, Jack wouldn't think them vermin, and although the stone had weathered over 6 centuries, it had originally been carved to represent decay. Stella caught March's conversation.
When do you start? Yeah, so what did you expect? Planting cabbages isn't rocket science. Wait, what do you mean you're here? Go outside. Now. Christ, I'm not flirting. She's just a cleaner. And no, actually, she's not. Her name's Beverly. Yeah. I'm on my...
March's voice faded. Stella heard the boom of the north porch door shutting. Twice. Just a cleaner. Over the decades, she'd grown used to those whose carpets she'd vacuumed and toilets she'd sluiced, discounting her. It was almost worse when they treated her as a friend and told her their problems. Whoever March was talking to had been in the abbey. Perhaps one of the other cleaners. There were 3 on today. But he'd ordered whoever it was to leave, and the team shift wouldn't be finished for an hour. Likely it was a jealous partner. Stella felt for whoever it was. Jackie reckoned people were jealous when the other person was distant and ungiving. It made the jealous person think others got what they didn't. Since Stella had been in Tewkesbury, this had made sense. Jack got jealous. Was Stella ungiving? Whatever, Stella did know that jealousy was a scary emotion. It could lead to murder. Once a woman of action and super efficiency, Stella Darnell, 53, last birthday, would have been impatient at having to consider the age and fragility of an object when cleaning. Her job was to make things look as good as new. She would have been horrified to abandon usual standards. But nowadays, Stella understood fragility. She didn't require a cadaver tomb to warn her about the reality of death. Stella retracted the handle of the spiderweb brush and packed it in her trolley. Never mind if the likes of Roddy Marsh dubbed her just a cleaner. She hoped that if she looked after the abbey, it would look after her. Stella wandered the streets in the village of Winchcombe, steeped in nostalgia for past times, laced with grief for all she had lost. In the grounds of Sudley Castle, she unclipped Stanley's lead and threw him a tennis ball. He quickly tired of the game, leaving her to fetch it herself. Stella was recovering from what she thought of as an emotional meltdown. After years of working at full tilt to keep her grief at the sudden death of her father 7 years before at bay, she had been engulfed by it. She had upped sticks from her London life, running her cleaning company, the man she loved, and had retreated to Gloucestershire. Winchcombe was 40 minutes from Tewkesbury. The last time she'd been there was with Jack. A different life. Stella had to admit, idiot, that she had hoped to find him there. Stanley had too, perhaps, because when they passed what had been a mean, tumble-down cottage squeezed between larger buildings in a back lane, the scene of a murder that she and Jack had solved, he'd strained towards the door. Now adorned with hanging baskets and a slate nameplate, it had become a Cotswold dream home. On Abbey Terrace, the other murder house caused Stella's heart to take a dive. She and Jack had fantasised about living there. His kids would join them, Jack had said. We're not put off by a body in the hall. As they passed now, Stanley showed no interest, as if, like Stella, he'd never believed in the dream. Stella was unfazed by murder. It was life and all it threw at her from which she shrank. The business of a live-in relationship, all the day-to-day stuff. Then, one day, you die. Dusk was gathering as Stella trundled the van along the old Brockhampton Road. She wasn't expected anywhere, but as she disliked driving in the countryside at night, she knew she should soon set off for Tewkesbury, but had one more visit. Angling her van onto a verge by a five-bar gate, Stella released Stanley from his jump seat and, checking for vehicles, let him out. Stanley, who all day had been as sluggish as she felt, shot out, wriggling under the gate and galloped off across a ploughed field. In the dwindling light, his champagne-coloured coat was a smudge against the ploughed soil. Stella climbed the gate and stumbled along a claggy furrow. No panic, she knew exactly where he'd gone. Crow's Nest stood in the middle of the next field at the end of a track. When she and Jack had stayed there, initially Stella, rarely afraid, was spooked by the darkness and silence. A townie, every field looked identical and, for the boss of a cleaning company, too muddy. Regardless, with Jack there, Crow's Nest had soon felt like home. She had come to see the specificity in wild flowers, the hedgerows and clusters of grasses. She could appreciate blackthorn, beech, teasels and sedum. That was then. No longer the boss of a cleaning company, now she was in the countryside alone, and again she saw only fields and mud. When Stella reached the track, she found Stanley rigidly staring into the gloom. She saw why. He did not recognise where he was. In place of the ramshackle, mock-Tudor house with a sagging roof and rotting timbers, was a glass and steel cube with wraparound balconies. Stella's ghosts had fled. She could not evoke Jack. The quiet was profound and all-encompassing, a thing in itself. She stumbled back to the van, Stanley at her heels. Never go back. You can't cheat the passing of time. No more memory lane. As she accelerated out of Winchcombe along dark, winding roads bordered by impregnable hedges, Stella lamented the lack of light. Shadows leapt and shrivelled in the headlamps. As grim-faced, she hugged the wheel and fervently hoped that nothing would come towards her. The twisty byways with hidden ditches and protruding dry stone walls offered few passing places. Spears of light pierced the darkness ahead. As she rounded a bend, Stella saw that they were rear lights. A van was travelling in the same direction as her. But where most locals averaged 60, hounding her bumper before overtaking, the van, white like her own, was crawling at 15 miles per hour. Stella hung back. In daylight she wouldn't have minded tootling along, but now she wanted to get back. The van stopped. Stella slammed on the brakes. The interior of her own van was washed with lurid red light from the rear lamps. She waited. It must have stalled. She wrapped a tattoo on the wheel, then caught herself on the edge of another simmering rage. Grief could make you angry, she'd read. The driver could have been taken ill. She should get out and check. Her own lights were on full beam. She dimmed them. She dazzled the driver and he or she had stopped to let her know. Sorry. She toggled the lights. The brake lights went out. All the lights were off. Although Stella was also driving a white Peugeot partner, she assumed the driver was male. She shivered, not from cold. The heater was on full. Stanley growled. The man might have been taken ill or unconscious, or his battery had died. She had jump leads. Thinking to help, Stella reached for the door handle. Stanley's whimpers recalibrated to a dreadful cry that was eerily human. The thing about dogs was they could be reassuring company or crank up your nerves to sheer terror. Stella was paralysed. The van was stationary. The lights were off. A spattering rain began to fall. Automatically, Stella flicked on the wipers. The creak of the blades dragging across the windscreen nearly stopped her heart. Stella had no way out. In the narrow lane, she couldn't turn or reverse. The rear mirror reflected black like a void. Stella grabbed her phone from the console. No signal. Exactly why she preferred towns. The van's driver door was opening. Stella stiffened, her mind racing. Her own doors were locked, but a wrench like the one in her van, therefore likely in his too, could smash through glass. She smacked clammy hands on her trousers and dry swallowed. Stella knew, even as she got out, she was making a mistake. Stanley gave a shrill bark. She was watching herself in slow motion, one foot on the tarmac, the other... Light speared through the back window of Stella's van. Another vehicle was coming down the narrow road behind her. Stella slammed her palm on the hazard light button. The phantom van in front trickled forward, still with no lights. It gathered speed and slipped away into the teeming dark. Fired by adrenaline, her breathing ragged, Stella's foot shuddered on the accelerator and she bunny-hopped the van a few metres. It was then she noticed the time on the dash. 10 to 6. On the Tewkesbury Road, wipers swiping away streaming rain, Stella reached 40. It wasn't true that she didn't have to be anywhere. The Death Cafe began at 6. Chapter 3. Wednesday, the 11th of December, 1940. 7 p.m. Wednesday. 13 shopping days until Christmas. In the sulphurous dark, pedestrians, shop workers, as if in a giant game of blind man's bluff, fumbled across Hammersmith Broadway. Blackout had been in force since 5:24 p.m. Late commuters emerging from the underground station, jostled with shelterers descending into the Hades of makeshift camps, patrolled by looters and chancers that every night lined the Piccadilly Line platforms. "Epitaph for a spy," read the headline of a copy of the Daily Express, lying in a gutter, and captioned beneath the photograph, "Judgment of death was duly executed of one of the two notices outside Pentonville Prison yesterday." Maple Greenhill set her jaw. Her dad had said that, little older than Maple at 24, Josie Wahlberg, one of the spies, was too young to die. "Old enough to be a traitor," Vernon had said. Crisply elegant in a reefer coat, blonde hair rolled, sabots crunching on fragments of glass littering even those streets that had escaped bombing. Maple felt the draught of a trolley bus, the silent peril, and veered away from the curb. When anyone could be killed at any moment, two men who planned to kill them all deserved to hang. You couldn't feel sorry for spies. What if it was Vernon? Aleck had promised Maple that when it was conscription, he'd put in a word for Vern. Aleck knew people. Maple was haunted by the memory of William, her boy, at 3 in no danger of dying as a soldier, sobbing in his nana's arms on their doorstep. She'd promised she was only going up the shop for cigarettes. She'd heard his cries all the way up Corny Road. Her mum stayed there to make her feel bad.
"Don't tell him lies. He'll never forgive you."
The arrest of the spies was meant to reassure the British public that the Germans were losing. But if two men could land in Dungeness with recording equipment in posh suitcases, Maple reckoned William's nightmares of Nazis coming down the Thames or out of the sky was likely. Her mum had shouted,
"It's your baby you should be with, not some fancy man." "I'm seeing Ida," she had shouted, almost believing it. "I don't have a fancy man."
Not a lie. Aleck was her fiancé, not some fly-by-night like William's dad. "I'm thinking of Will," Maple had said to herself as, on the tram, she'd wiped William's teary snot off her gorgeous plum-red coat and rearranged the mink, which made her mother's lips pucker in mute disapproval. That was after Maple had offered to do the blackout curtains, which nearly killed her. St. Paul's Church bells chimed 7. The thickened air rendered the peals directionless. They came from everywhere as if rung by God himself. As it trundled away, the trolley bus missed a taxi which, hearse-like in the swirling dark, turned into Brook Green Road and halted outside the Palais de Danse. A crowd was milling around the blacked-out doors. Tonight, it was rumoured Glenn Miller and his band would do a spot before flying out of RAF Northolt.
I say,
Aleck paid off the taxi, and Trim, in belted coat and Trilby, stepped up to Maple and took her by the shoulders.
It's Tallulah Banghead.
He kissed her forehead.
Get on with you.
Maple reached up and brushed his cheek, noting his smooth skin. She adjusted her stole. No bloke ever compared her to a film star. Fancy her, a typist at the dairy, being engaged to a man with a proper job. She'd whispered to William as she pinned up the living room blackout that very soon they would be living happily ever after. Now, Maple said,
Dad says, seeing as we're engaged, he wants to meet you.
She gave a light laugh to smother the little fib.
You've to come to tea Sunday.
At that moment, in Corny Road, Chiswick, crouched in the Anderson shelter with his wife, son and little grandson, Keith Greenhill knew nothing of this. He did indeed want to meet Aleck, the nameless scoundrel who was playing about with his daughter. The mink told Keith, as it had told his wife, that Maple's fancy man was at best a trickster who'd signed up to the forces to escape responsibility, like the shiftless fellow who'd left Maple in the lurch. As he gazed at Maple's distraught lad, cried out in his wife's arms, Keith Greenhill vowed to get him by the scruff of the neck and tell him. Neither of them would sleep until Maple got back, which, from recent experience, they knew would be the small hours.
Whoever he is, the scoundrel lacks the decency to walk her home. Greenhill leaned close to his wife to be heard above the cacophony of the guns. We'll have to have it out with her. Give her time, she'll tell us. Well, she said time. See how the land lies in the morning.
Evelyn stroked a cowlick from William's forehead.
She really could be seeing Ida.
Pigs might fly.
Vernon, the Greenhill's 21-year-old son, who was slumped by the shelter's entrance, roused himself.
Do you know something? Keith demanded.
Course not.
Vernon pulled the horsehair blanket up over his chin and rolled over to sleep. His parents exchanged a look. They didn't believe him. The ground shook with a bomb that they knew wasn't as near as it sounded. Huddled in the cold damp of their newly constructed shelter, which Keith complained was cheap and nasty and not up to the job, the Greenhills retreated into private terror. Everyone knew the Nazis were not the only enemy. There was talk of women being raped in public shelters, old people attacked in their homes for savings and gold watches. Danger lurked around every corner. Maple should hurry up and come home. The palais doors shifted briefly ajar, and, gripping Maple's elbow, Aleck piloted her into a world of glitter and magic, where Hammersmith Broadway was Hollywood and, even as sirens wailed, one might believe the Blitz could be kept at bay. Lamps, wreathed in a bluish canopy of cigarette smoke, cast ghostly light over a boiling mass. Ecstatic faces were caught in a match's flare, red lipstick, sleek, oiled hair. The floor was marked with scuffed chalk marks from where the BBC had snaked cables for the Forces Sunday broadcast of Services Spotlight, the dance hall slot in the Sunday Nighters. Tonight's swing band sound, not Glenn Miller, bounced off walls plastered with posters that urged women to take up factory work. Tonight's gas mask ball was thrown to encourage Londoners to carry masks. Not really Hollywood. For Maple, as she danced her life away, a gas mask and doing war work were the last things on her mind. Last week, when she'd told Aleck about William, he'd just kissed her quiet and undone her blouse. We all make mistakes. The next time they'd met, he'd given her the mink and, from deep inside her, his hands around her hips, asked her to marry him. William wasn't a mistake. Maple hadn't told Aleck the toddler with pudgy legs and such a cheeky smile was the best thing in her life. Every man liked to come first. Aleck always got the barman's attention. As he handed Maple the first of several daiquiris, he told her, "Chin chin, baby." They swooped and swirled to "I'll never smile again" and "easy to love." Alec's hand on the small of Maple's back slipped lower. He pressed her to him and she felt his love. For her. If she was Tallulah Bankhead, he was James Stewart from Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. She'd tell him later. Maybe when he came to tea. Watching the couple from the bar, a woman whose husband had been killed in a U-boat attack, who expected never to smile again, felt gin-infused hope. It was for such love Britain was fighting, a better world in which everyone cared. Then the man and his girl were lost amid the throng, and the woman felt desolate as if, with their departure, had gone all chance of happiness. Later, spotting a polite notice for customers at the Palais on the night of the 11th to come forward with any information about a murdered girl, Una Hughes recognised her. She was able to give the divisional detective an excellent description of the couple. On the corner nearest the river, an incendiary had ripped away the front of a house to reveal a tableau of shattered domesticity. In dancing flames, as if in a magic lantern show, was a carpeted staircase cut off before the landing, the bathroom mirror above a pallid sink still intact. The stern portrait of a Victorian grandee hanging askew above the drawing-room mantelpiece frowned upon the front area, infilled with smashed brick and timber, crockery and broken furniture displaced by the blast. Mabel couldn't believe it would happen to her mum and dad's home, their pride and joy. Since Aleck, she felt she and all those she loved would be safe. The road was blocked by an AFS team attacking flames from a burst gas pipe in the kitchen. In intervals between guns and distant bombing was the grind of the pump engine. Urgent shouts, "Ruddy low tide! Where's the fireboat? Shift the turntable!" Helmeted firefighters, two of them women, like cut-out figures in the orange light which suffused the cobbled road as if it were paved with gold. Guiding Maple past the crisscross of vehicles, between pooling water and rubble, Aleck whispered in her ear, "Wardens dug the family from the cellar 2 nights ago. Crystal pulp, all of them. Mind you, the wife was on short commons and riddled with cancer when I opened her up. Handy, really. She got a painless death." He nuzzled into Maple's neck. Maple imagined telling her mum and dad how there was little Aleck doesn't know about London's dead, his phrase. Now, she said, "It's not fair getting ill in a war. Everything like that should stop. At least we got those spies." She liked to show Aleck she was up on things. "Nothing's fair, Maple. Blighters got their just desserts." Smoky clouds were thinning to the west. Light from a fitful moon flickered on the Thames. A mud-slicked cobbled causeway, accessible when the tide receded, led to the Eyot, an outcrop of land overgrown with reeds and stubby trees. The stench of charred timber and damp mortar was stronger on the shoreline. "It's the smell of death," Maple said, to sound clever.
"Death doesn't smell like that," Aleck said.
"Here we are."
Skirting poles on trestles that protected a large house on Chiswick Mall, he flicked his torch over a board propped against the gate. Danger, structure unsafe, and led Maple up the path of a house on three floors with rooms either side of the door. Despite the danger sign, it looked undamaged. Maple would tell her dad that Aleck saw past danger. She felt safe with him. Her dad was always worrying. He'd cried during Chamberlain's speech. Aleck said the war had been good to him. It was good to her, too. If not for Hitler, she wouldn't have met Aleck and he'd never have proposed.
"This is yours?"
Maple gasped when Aleck fitted a key into the front door. Aleck usually found an alley at the end of gardens behind shops, hidden by bins. The first time Maple had worried they should wait until it was decent. Aleck told her,
"There's a war on. Rules have changed."
"Of course not."
He pocketed the key and opened the door.
"Are we allowed?"
"I'm allowed."
"Who does live here?"
Maple blinked in the encompassing light of a vast chandelier. A small voice suggested,
"We will."
"A friend."
Aleck shucked off his coat, folded it and placed it across the post at the bottom of the staircase.
"Is he here?"
Maple darted a look up the stairs.
"So many questions." Aleck gave a braying laugh.
"We've never done it in a bed. Will your friend mind?"
Shouting above the endless clatter of guns, Maple felt appalled. It had to be Aleck's idea to do it, and she must act surprised.
"What if he comes home?"
"He won't."
Aleck lifted off Maple's mink stole and pulled off her coat, his gift. Tugging her, he went into a room off the hall. A table lamp gave a soft circle of light. Aleck tossed Maple's things onto a wingback chair. The coat slipped off onto a Turkey carpet, but he didn't notice. Without it, Maple shivered. The ashes in the grate looked cold, and she imagined asking Aleck to make up a fire, but in another man's house, that would be cheeky.
"He's never coming back. Oliver Hurrell, aged 53, solicitor of this parish, unmarried with no living relatives, was killed by shrapnel fire-watching at the Commodore yesterday. Our acquaintance began and ended at Hammersmith Mortuary."
Aleck often said the dead were his friends. Sometimes, despite her pride in him, Mabel wished he wouldn't. Afterwards, flicking on his lighter, Aleck lit them each a cigarette. He shuffled to sitting, his back against the sofa.
"Tallulah Bankhead wouldn't sit in her birthday suit in a dead man's house without a ring on her finger. James Stewart wouldn't let her."
Not used to smoking, Mabel took kissing puffs of her cigarette. A settee was a far cry from an alley, but it was not a bridal chamber.
"What are you talking about now?"
Aleck blew smoke ribbons at the rose ceiling moulding.
"I think we should not meet like this, not until we're married. Ida said you had to put your foot down or things got out of hand." "It's not me you lost your virginity with, dearie."
Aleck narrowed his eyes.
"And let's face it, you never take persuading." "What about Sunday? Dad's expecting you. Mum's making a cake with eggs."
Coughing as she inhaled, Mabel began gathering her clothes from the carpet where Aleck had strewn them. Her toes snagged a stocking and tears pricked. Real silk, they had cost more than a day's wages. When she'd fallen pregnant, her younger brother Vernon called her a tart. He'd gone with her dad to Bertie Spence's lodgings in Fulham to find that the hod carrier had signed up the day before. Keith Greenhill had made Vernon say sorry. "Treat your older sister with respect." Yet Vernon was only saying what her parents felt.
"A bed would have been nice," Mabel mumbled.
Watching Aleck tap his cigarette into an ashtray on an occasional table, she noted that, apart from tie and jacket, he hadn't so much as dropped his trousers. She'd never seen him in the altogether.
"Have sense, Mabel," Aleck flipped up his braces. "I couldn't raise the flag in a dead man's bed." "I bet you could."
Pressing a dampened finger to the silk, Mabel made a fruitless attempt to close the nick.
"Mum's gone to town with baking."
She made it up as she went along, then, seeing her coat in a heap, felt annoyed that Aleck had treated it badly. Not caring meant his present to her was worth nothing to him. Aleck didn't help her into it as he had in the palais. Watching him tighten his tie, her fingers rummaged restlessly in her coat pockets as, tottering on one high heel, she trod into the other shoe. To fend off the feeling of being dirty and wrong, she persisted.
What time on Sunday? Will three do? Let's not rush it, Mabel.
He smoothed back his hair.
It's been 3 months. By rights, you should have asked Dad about marrying me.
Mabel probed at something. Not in the pocket, it was caught in the pocket lining.
I didn't mean it, silly girl. We men promise anything in the heat of the moment.
Mabel knew that. The hod carrier had promised her a diamond ring. Aleck was meant to be quite different. She worried at a tiny tear in the lining and hooked out a bit of paper. Smoothing it, she showed it to the lamplight.
Who's Julia?
In the street, the all clear sounded.
What?
Aleck mashed his cigarette in the ashtray.
This is a mending ticket for Julia Northcote, I think it says. My sister. You said you were an only child.
Mabel might be an optimist, but she was no fool. When not blinded by dreams, she could tell when a man was lying.
My wife, Aleck looked angry. Good God, who else would it be? You're married.
Cold as ice, Mabel rivaled Tallulah Bankhead.
You're a liar. My dad will have your guts. All the time you...
Mabel shoved the paper back in her pocket and strode to the door. She turned incandescent.
You think you can palm me off with her cast-offs? We'll see about that.
Mabel never reached the herringbone-tiled hall. Aleck caught up with her and, whipping off his tie, slipped it over her head. He yanked her close. Several Londoners, creeping back to their homes after the raid, heard the scream. One woman told the detective she assumed the lady had seen a mouse. The caretaker at nearby flats said it wasn't his business what went on behind closed doors. Chapter 4, December 2019. Stella. Stella hesitated at the door to the Abbey Gardens tea shop. Through the steamed-up window, a group clustered at the servery, a man and two women. Another woman, tall with a mass of curly black hair, was handing out teas and coffees from behind the counter. She looked faintly familiar, but Stella knew no one in Tewkesbury. The smaller tea tables had been pushed to the wall, leaving the large circular table in the centre of the parquet floor, which, as cleaner for the tea shop, Stella would be mopping at 6 a.m. tomorrow. Not too late to change her mind and leave. But after the scary incident on the lane, Stella was in no hurry to return to the empty flat and spend the evening alone. Choice was taken from her when the door opened and a man greeted her.
"I'm a bit late."
Stella saw it was 3 minutes past six.
"Dust is the enemy of time. It clogs the cogs. Come inside, my dear. Punctuality is a concept. Ooh, Fred, there's no booze."
His bass tone was surprising for such a tall, reedy frame. Stella caught the aroma of coffee and could see a fire burning in the grate.
"I didn't expect alcohol." Stella planned to keep a clear head. "Are you in charge?"
"Oh, God, no, no. Mademoiselle Felicitations is running the show. The Amazon lady doling out weak tea and no sympathy over there. Come, 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 come. You're letting in the cold air."
Doffing an imaginary cap, he scooted Stella inside.
"Clive Burgess at your service, ma'am."
"Stella." The man smelled of something which, after a moment, Stella identified as horoline, the cleaning fluid for clocks she knew from a museum she'd cleaned in London.
"And I bet you are."
Clive Burgess shook her hand and, perhaps seeing her quizzical expression, said,
"Stella, star."
"Oh, right."
Stella looked around for a means of escape. The tea room had been transformed. The table, draped with a dark mauve tablecloth shaded by a lamp, put her in mind of a séance. An impression not lessened by the sugar-dusted Victoria sponge perched on one of the tea shop's pottery cake stands. Stella kept Stanley on a short lead. It would be disastrous if he snatched the cake.
"Tread carefully. It's her first bash at this Death Cafe malarkey. She's a bit windy about it. Upset her and death might come to all of us quicker than we'd like."
Hands resting on the back of the chair, the man laughed wheezily. Looking at him properly, Stella saw he was even older than his jaunty energy suggested, perhaps 80. Seeing Stanley, he said,
"I say, are dogs allowed?"
"I didn't ask. I'll leave."
Stella grasped the legitimate escape route.
"Don't you dare."
The man stretched his arms across the door, barring Stella's exit.
"We'll sink in this ship together."
"I'm sure it will be fine."
Stella hadn't anticipated small talk. The notice in the tea room described the Death Cafe as an opportunity to explore the meaning of death. Stella had promised to come, so would not bail out. She slung her anorak over a chair at the séance table and approached the servery.
"Are dogs allowed?"
Nervous, Stella repeated Clive's question and forgot to say hello.
"I don't see why not, as long as he behaves himself."
Up close, Stella realised she did know the woman who had signed her email, Felicity Branscombe. Or not so much know her as had seen her before. She had conducted the choir in the Abbey when Stella had been there for evensong. She, too, had to be over 70. In her early 50s, Stella wondered if she should come back later, 20 years later.
"I'm Stella," she told Felicity. "We'll do introductions in a mo. There's builder's tea, sachets of a ghastly herbal concoction that promises to send you to sleep, and coffee. No milk, it got spilt. Serving beverages is harder than performing an autopsy." Felicity banged a bowl of sugar onto the counter. "I hope you weren't expecting wine. As I told Clive, the purpose of this evening is honest discussion, not getting plastered. The Death Cafe lot say you have to provide refreshments, or, frankly, I'd get on with it."
"Black coffee, please."
Stella was startled at the reference to an autopsy. Presumably Felicity had to keep on a death theme. Once everyone was seated, Felicity distributed perfectly cut slices of the cake on paper plates. Opposite Stella and Stanley, held tightly on Stella's lap,
was an overweight woman, the fringe of her iron-grey bob clamped with a slide shaped like an elephant tusk. Stella reckoned the woman was late 60s. Her demeanour was grim, a weird contrast to her brightly coloured Elizabethan-style tunic embroidered with deer and rabbits who were being chased by men firing arrows.
"Does he molt?" the woman was looking at Stanley. "I'm allergic."
No. Stella clutched Stanley tighter, which made him struggle to jump down. "He's made of wool."
"I do hope so," the woman said.
"Oh, don't panic, Joy," an elderly woman shut the door to the toilets next to the servery. "You're more likely to get asthma from my Angora jumper." Sitting down next to Stella, the woman winked at her. Stella took in the auburn-coloured bob and turquoise polo neck. The woman arranged a silver quilted jacket around her shoulders.
"Evening, Gladys," the Tudor woman said.
Seeing how smartly dressed all three women were, Stella felt embarrassed by her fleece, worn since cleaning the abbey that morning. She'd left no time to go home and change. Sticking to the rules of a death cafe, Felicity informed them she was their facilitator and asked everyone to go gently into the night with me. It's my first time in the hot seat. She listed ground rules. Mobile phones off, and said not to promote your business, particularly if you are an undertaker or sell wreaths. A death cafe is not a bereavement support group. If your loved one is recently deceased and your grief raw, this ain't for you. She rested her gaze on Clive, who was on a second slice of Victoria sponge, and looked to Stella the picture of chirpiness. For herself, she welcomed the no-tears rule. Were she to start crying, Stella feared she'd never stop.
"Tell us why you have come tonight. Offer us a point for discussion. What do you hope to take away?"
Glancing up from what looked like a crib sheet, Felicity's smile revealed a row of expensive-looking teeth. All Stella could think she must take away was her rucksack, which last week she'd left in the abbey after evensong.
"We'll start with Mrs. Gladys Wren."
Felicity pointed her fountain pen at the woman in the silver jacket.
"Please tell the group your name and what you do for a living." "Oh, you've given it away."
Gladys Wren raised eyebrows dyed to match her hair.
"Landlady, for my sins. Now, what do I say?"
"Why you're here?" Tudor Tunic rolled her eyes.
"Oh, call me Gladys."
Gladys toyed with her cake.
"It was recommended by a friend. Death is never far away, is it? My hubby Derek always said when it was my turn they'd have found a vaccine. He said I got younger by the day. God rest him."
"That's nonsense," the Tudor woman said. "How terrible would it be if everyone around this table never died?"
"A lovely contribution, Gladys," Felicity said. "What will you take with you?" "Oh, a bit of this lovely cake if Mr. Burgess hasn't scoffed the lot."
Gladys angled her fork at Clive, the elderly man who had greeted Stella.
"It's so light and buttery. Did you make it, Felicity?"
"Shop-bought," Felicity made an irrelevant gesture with her hand.
"I came here,"
poking about in a plastic crocodile skin bag, Gladys dug out a well-thumbed Donald Duck notebook and flicked through the pages.
"For shopping lists, here it is. To face death in the face. That sounds silly when you say it out loud."
"Death is all around, everywhere you look," the Tudor woman said.
"Oh, no, there's a song," Gladys waggled a finger. "Love is all around."
"It was 15 weeks in 1994 for Wet, Wet, Wet." Stella liked statistics.
"After Derek's time, or he'd have swept me off my feet."
Humming the tune, Gladys swayed in her seat and, unprompted by her Donald Duck book,
"Grief never leaves you. No day goes by when Derek isn't with me. 10 years is 10 minutes.
And to Felicity,
"Oh, don't you worry, lovey. I shan't cry." "Do any of you have a subject we can air as a group?"
Felicity tapped her paper.
While we're on the subject of death,"
Gladys flicked to the back of the notebook and, flattening the pages, read out in halting tones a sentence written across two pages. Stella was no handwriting expert, yet she didn't associate the bold scrawl in green ink with Gladys.
"What I want to know is,"
Gladys turned the book diagonal to better read,
"who here wishes someone was dead?"
"I know one who shall remain nameless." Stella was impressed that Gladys had come prepared. She herself had not.
"I'm sure we all do, but it's not our purpose tonight. Is there anything apart from cake you hope to take away?"
Stella felt for Felicity. Chairing the group was like herding cats.
"Happiness," Gladys heaved her shoulders. "Since Derek... Oops, there we go again. He will pop up."
She hunched into her silver jacket and fell silent.
"Lovely, Gladys."
Felicity crossed out what looked to Stella like Gladys's name. She imagined Felicity thinking, "One down, three to go." Stella hoped time would run out before Felicity got to her.
"Joy, you're next," Felicity said. "Name, occupation, why you're here, etc." "Joy by name, Joy by nature," said the woman called Joy in the hunting tunic. "Oh, you hide that well, lovey,"
Gladys grinned at Joy.
"Welcome, Joy. Lovely that you could come with all you have on your busy plate," Felicity cut in.
With a tendency to think literally, Stella noted that Joy hadn't touched the cake on her plate. Stella had nibbled at hers. The scary incident on the dark lane had killed her appetite. She hugged Stanley closer, not forgetting that, however sleepy he appeared to be, the cake would be the only thing on his mind.
"I expect to take away what I came with. Common sense. We will all die, and for some of us the end will be sooner than for others."
Joy jutted a determined chin.
"No point in beating about the bush."
Stella came out in a sweat. Going clockwise around the table, after Joy, was Clive, who was consulting a silver fob watch attached to his waistcoat. Then it would be her turn.
"Organist of the Abbey, I'm the first woman. My male predecessor died."
Joy nodded.
"I'm not a feminist, but it was time. My dear father taught me, leave your mark, don't let sleeping dogs lie. The marvellous grove organ on the north side of the choir is my path to immortality. I shall not be forgotten."
She traced one of the embroidered rabbits with a stubby finger.
"I want to discuss the last image we want to see as life ebbs from the corporeal form. And mine is Da Vinci's The Last Supper. His Jesus is my father to a T."
Joy seemed to be one of those people, like Lucy, who, the more confidential what they had to say was, the louder they said it.
"Oh, my old man was more of a Tommy Trinder," Gladys said. "The person I want to see as I die is Derek. He was my saviour."
Joy made a short, scornful sound that made Stella want to rescue Gladys.
"No one can be a saviour. We have to save ourselves."
Joy looked disapproving. Stella felt blind panic. She had no idea what she wanted to see. It haunted her that her father's last view, he died outside the co-op, was a grubby pavement in a small seaside town. It had been a huge mistake to come.
"Who would like to speak next?"
A flush was creeping up Felicity's neck. Stella supposed that her first death cafe wasn't going to plan and considered stepping in. Jack said Stella had to stop wanting to rescue people. They must find their own way. She hadn't rescued Jack. Stella was considering holding her nose and getting it over with when the door flew open and a blast of wind and rain blew in a tall woman, beanie pulled over her ears, mud-streaked parka coat dripping on the parquet. She flung herself onto a chair between Clive and Gladys and, shrugging out of her parka, bashed at the knees of equally muddy denim overalls as if to clean them. Her face was almost hidden by a khaki snood, yet it was easy to tell she was scowling ferociously. All Stella cared about was that now the newcomer would speak before her.
"You're late. What is your name and why have you come?"
Felicity said, which to Stella's mind sounded really quite rude.
"Well, I only remember once I got home. I had to cycle back,"
came the muffled reply.
"Andrea!"
"We've only just started," Stella came to the rescue.
"I know."
Andrea did a duh expression as if this was a no-brainer.
"Yes, Ducky, you settle down. I'd take those wet things off or you'll get a chill in your kidneys."
Gladys Wren's concern nearly had Stella crying after all. Her own mother loved her, but expressions of concern came out as terse strictures.
Gladys was explaining to Andrea, "We have to say what we hope to get from here."
"Get warm and then not get soaked on the way home."
"We've all made sacrifices to be here," Felicity beamed at the group. This is Andrea, everyone. Welcome, Andrea.
Hardly, Andrea said.
Hi there.
Stella nodded to her, but Andrea was scowling at Stanley.
Didn't know we could bring dogs.
Have you got a dog?
Clive leaned unnecessarily close to Andrea.
No,
Andrea said. It amazed Stella, brought up to be polite by warring parents, how perfect strangers could think nothing of being rude to each other. Although, aside from Andrea and herself, it seemed that everyone else knew each other. Only to be expected in a small town. Stella knew it was contrary, but horrified at making light conversation with the group, she also felt obscure resentment at being an outsider. No question of pairing with Andrea, she appeared to have taken an instant dislike to Stella.
I'll throw in my hat,
the elderly man cleared his throat, loudly.
Clive's my name. Footloose and fancy-free is my nature.
He snatched off his wire-framed glasses and, puffing on the lenses, buffed them vigorously with his stained tie.
Joy, if by feminist you mean one who loves women, c'est moi.
That's not being a feminist, that's a lesbian, which I doubt you are, Clive. Some women are frightened they'll be mistaken for gay if they admit to preferring women-only spaces.
Joy spoke to the fobwatch man as if he were a child.
I, for example, am not a lesbian. However, I won't hide bitter disappointment that my expectation that this discussion would exclude men has proved to be false.
I'll be whatever you like, Joyous.
Clive waggled his glasses like Eric Morecambe.
Is that about death?
Andrea glared at Joy and Clive.
Men die as much as women. Why wouldn't they be here?
Paying attention to the group's dynamics, Jack would if he was there, Stella decided Andrea's animosity was indiscriminate and not aimed at her. But how odd to come, since she clearly didn't want to be there.
So, I'm an...
Clive was drowned out by Rod Stewart. Stella recognised the first cut is the deepest.
That's mine. I have to go.
Felicity was frowning at her phone.
Ooh, hoisted by your own mobile phone's off petard, my dear.
Clive's glasses were steamed up. Stella couldn't see his eyes.
We'll tell you what we all took away with us.
Joy appeared marginally more cheerful.
Sorry, but it means you all have to leave too. I'm responsible for locking up the tea room. We shall continue tomorrow night.
What if we're busy tomorrow?
Andrea ran the zip up and down her parka, reminding Stella of Jack's four-year-old daughter Millie when she was cross. Heading across the tea room with the remains of the cake, Felicity flung up the counter flap and shouldered the door to the servery. Stella and Gladys were gathering up mugs when they heard her call.
Don't help! I'm far better on my own!
No one noticed Stanley hoovering up crumbs under the table. Chapter 5. Thursday, the 12th of December, 1940.
Good to see you, Doc. Struth, you got here quick.
George Cotton strode into a room crowned with several dark wood cabinets, a high-backed sofa, armchairs and plant stands. A technician was arranging arc lamps delivered by one of the police vans.
I was close by,
Dr. Northcote smiled. The two men shook hands. One, a divisional detective pulled away from retirement on his allotment to replace conscripted police officers. The other, at 39, already a celebrated home office pathologist, were divided by class and did not meet socially, but mutual regard ensured each was relieved to find the other at the scene of a murder.
Not quick enough to save French Annie,
Northcote indicated the body of a young woman lying twisted at the foot of the sofa. Killer can't be far. She is still warm.
Christ's sakes!
Cotton spun on his heel and rushed out of the house. His voice rang in the street as he bellowed at the three constables clustered by the gate.
Check every house, alleyway, the dustbins, shelters and gardens. There's a public one near the Black Lion. Boats, skiffs. If he's on the Eyot, he'll be stranded. Comb every ruddy inch and...
Cotton waved a hand at a houseboat moored nearby. Take that apart. He heaved a breath.
There's a monster out there. Find him.
Cotton was still panting when he returned to the murder room. He noted the upturned chair and rucked turkey carpet. She must have struggled. Surprising not more neighbours didn't hear.
There was a red on, don't forget.
Dr. Northcote was crouched, the skirts of his coat between his haunches.
Anyway, people keep themselves to themselves these days, you know that.
Unless they're nicking stuff from dead people's destroyed homes. I could swing for the schoolteacher we nabbed last night. He'd stolen a wireless set off a woman killed by a strike because his own had stopped working. How such minds work beats me. Cotton raked through dark hair, which took years of his actual age of 46. No morals, Dr. Northcote agreed. Standing next to the pathologist, George Cotton considered the corpse. He didn't need Northcote to put her at between 19 and 25, and she'd been pretty with looks that needed no makeup. Her fake blonde hair was washed and curled. If she'd been anything like June, that would have kept her busy. She'd probably worn curlers to bed last night. This picture pierced his heart. Thinking of June, Cotton said, I'm thinking that black velvet dress and her silk stockings cost a bob or two. The coat and this mink must have been given by a satisfied customer. Northcote was reading his thermometer. One stocking was torn at the calf. The tear, too slight, Cotton reckoned, to have occurred in her attempt to escape. One shoe was half off, the leg twisted beneath her at a dreadful angle. Definitely murder, not a question. Strangulation, George. The doctor pointed with a 6-inch rule. See those abrasions? My guess is a ligature, a length of material, a tie most probably. Wound on the back of her head is with a blunt instrument of some kind. The poker, perhaps? Cotton went to the large marble fireplace and examined a silver companion set beside the grate. It's here, at the back. I doubt he had the presence of mind to return it. I think an ashtray. The wound is less specific than the head of a poker. There isn't an ashtray here. Bet he pocketed it. Northcote got to his feet. Spur-of-the-moment thing, Cotton mused. Still warm, you said. I hate to give you a time, but on this occasion I can safely state French Annie here has only been dead about half an hour. Cotton didn't like Northcote's habit of referring to all dead women as Annie, whether French or old. No sign of anyone in the vicinity, sir. A young man with acne-scarred cheeks in a suit of what Cotton fretted was black market tweed, crime was no longer the proclivity of seasoned criminals, hovered by the door. Check if this address is where this lady lived, Shepherd. Cotton fiddled with the rim of his hat. There, I can help you, George. Northcote picked up his bag. The house owner is one Oliver Hurrell, aged 53. You know him? Cotton dreaded being called to the fatality of a friend. Only by death. Hurrell, solicitor of this parish, was killed by shrapnel fire-watching at the Commodore yesterday. Germans got there first, but the chap would have dropped dead of apoplexy soon enough. Arteries furred like London Underground cables and riddled with disease. He gave a tight smile. No relations. I'll show you the file on him. In that case, what was this woman doing here? Cotton rubbed his chin. All dressed for a night out. Not my job, but I'd say this lady was one of the blooms of the night. Northcote clipped shut his bag. She doesn't have the look of a prostitute. Her skin is too good. She looks well. Cotton wasn't arguing. This was how they worked. One posing a theory, the other expanding on it or countering with another. If she is, that outfit is too dear for picking up customers from the street. Her clients would be too high a class to meet her in deserted premises. Any evidence of sexual activity? More than once, I'm afraid. Northcote leaned down and almost tenderly, Cotton noticed, took up one of the dead woman's hands. Like you say, this girl fought like a cat. Look at her nails. I did find skin underneath them, so somewhere on his person our man has scratches. Any hair? Not one strand, so either he was bald as a coot, or, more likely, given the wound at the back of her head, she was caught by surprise. Some men see women's lives as cheap. At times like this, Cotton hated his job. Only an hour ago, this woman had her life before her. Another case of girl yours gentleman into vacant house for sex, then expects to fleece him. Northcote sighed. Cotton knew he and Northcote differed on this subject because, in his experience, men did the luring. How did she know it was empty? Hurrell was living here only days ago, Cotton thought aloud. I'm always saying, George, we should recruit Tarts to spy for Britain. They know exactly what's going on. They take on those German kids we hang today. Northcote adjusted his scarf against the chill in the unheated house and added, laughing, Perhaps we do employ them, what? Perhaps, Northcote and New Northcote meant the two spies who, stumbling ashore at Dungeness last month, had got themselves caught immediately and hanged at Pentonville on the morning of the 10th. One, at 24, was Shepherd's age. Cotton was alone amongst his colleagues in thinking capital punishment brutal. It never put felons off from killing people or, surely, in a war, committing treason. That was a decent score, Northcote's satisfaction reminded Cotton the pathologist had performed the post-execution autopsies. While Cotton could sometimes tire of policing, he never envied Northcote his job. While Northcote was packing up, Cotton did his own check of the house and ascertained it unlikely the woman and her killer strayed beyond the living room. When he returned, he said, "If a killer knew this place was empty, maybe he planned to kill her here." "How would he know?" Northcote said. "There's a danger sign outside, for a start. It rather suggests our man has killed other girls. Were that so, I might have expected to have them come through to me," Northcote said. "One thing, no handbag. Women always carry one. Mark you, he's deposited it in a nearby bin." "Spot on, George. Our killer won't want to be seen prancing along with some fancy handbag on his arm." Northcote was as much a detective as Cotton. Cotton was gazing at the twisted corpse. The set of her features, the determined chin, suggested Maple Greenhill had known her own mind. How had she ended up dead in an empty house?
"Sir?"
Shepherd was back. "Fingerprint man from the yards here." "Get him in, Tootsweet." Unlike some officers, Cotton welcomed anyone from the yard. You couldn't have too many cooks in the kitchen, and these days fingerprinting was more often than not a clincher.
"I'll start on her first thing, George."
Pausing, Northcote bowed his head to the dead woman and, donning his trilby, went out into the night. 2 hours later, P.C. Shepherd was driving George Cotton past the brewery on the way to Corney Road, the address on the young lady's ID card. As Northcote had predicted, police found her handbag in a bin near Iott Gardens. Maple's purse contained no cash, but along with the ID was a wage slip for the Express Dairies. On her modest weekly income, it would have taken Maple months to pay off her Jaeger coat. Otherwise, one lipstick, a powder puff in a squashed cardboard box, and, somewhat of a surprise, a copy of The Woman in White by Wilkie Collins, which Maple had borrowed from Boots. Her bookmark, an oblong of felt embroidered with the letters MVG, was tucked near the end. That Maple liked reading didn't fit Cotton's, and surely not Northcote's, portrait of a prostitute.
2 sets of prints in the house. Not much to go on, sir.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.